And we farmed rabbit because my daughter had severe food allergies. I've been raising two girls with autism, and my one is hearing impaired and has major food allergies. So from the time she was a baby, we had medical issues. And the big thing was we had been taken off of everything. She was gluten-free, peanut-free, dairy-free, egg-free. What do you do as a parent, right? So I grew up, my parents farming. I took agriculture at school, and then I did business after I finished my agriculture at the University of Manitoba. So with the severe food allergies, Kate ended up being taken off of meat. And I was like, why? What is going on? What am I going to feed my toddler? Like, how am I going to raise this little girl? So Brian and I racked our brains and did some research. And his big thing was, you know what? I did a bunch of research on rabbit. Let's look at rabbit, because we could control what was in the food. We could control what the animal was eating to feed my child. So we got researching and doing more and more and more. And then we fell in love with the thought of raising these rabbits. So we did it for our own family, for our own consumption. And it did wonderful things for my daughter. She was able to eat meat. I grew up, my parents owning a butcher shop and raising beef cattle. I couldn't imagine life without eating meat, let alone raising my kids not eating meat. So for me, it was this whole thing. We needed to use the whole animal because I hate waste. Owning a butcher shop, when you grew up, you used everything, right down to the bones, the livers, the hearts, the kidneys, everything. And, you know, I grew up like Joe, my gran, being out in the garden and using the land to resource her foods. So it was very important to me that we did that, but we had to do it with no antibiotics. We had to do it with no traditional methods. If you can move back, we're still not there yet. So one of the things that we did was we had to look at how we were going to raise these rabbits. So we started with a chinchilla meat rabbit, and we decided we wanted to be able to use the fur. They had a beautiful fur with four shades of gray when you blew on the fur. And that's how we came up with our name, Shades of Gray Rabbitry. And it was just a farm name at the time. Well, then of course the books and the movies and everything else hit, and it was like, oh, what do we do? And I said to Brian, I really don't know what to do with this. I said, do we keep the name? Do we change it? And he's like, no, we keep it. It's your family name. It's your legacy for the girls. It's their last name. We do it. That's what we named it. That's what we're doing. He said, we'll just ride the wave. So we did. So as we started farming, we ran into obstacles. Rabbits are prey animals. They're really hard to raise. They're really hard to produce. We had to find ways in the barn that were creative, that worked with our land, with the medicines of no antibiotics. When we first bought our rabbits, we had to figure out, how are we gonna move them home? How are we gonna take this herd we bought and get them home safely? So we literally did everything we could to research that animal. What was best for them? How do we move them? What do we do? So we took the time. We found ways to move them at night, under dark, where it was cool, where the environment was quiet. There wasn't as many vehicles on the road. And getting them home, and then finding ways in the barn over the years, how do we adjust their habitat so it's more natural for them? Taking all of our beliefs and how we raise our animals into play for the animal, to give them the best life we knew we could give them. Because as farmers, that's our job. That is our job. We do federally inspected meat, where we worked really hard to get into that federal plant. It took me 2 years of knocking on doors, phone calls, cold calling. I had to track the guy down that owned the federal plant on his four-wheeler and say, I want my meat done here. And literally that's how we got into the federal plant. We were on a back road, he was on his quad, and I said, I can get my meat into grocery stores. I need your help. I couldn't get through his staff. I've been there every 2 weeks since 2012 because of that conversation on a dirt road and him on his quad. So I guess my point in saying that to you is, don't ever give up. Do whatever you have to do to make your dream come true. My dream was to share that meat rabbit with anyone that had health issues, anyone that had allergies, that needed a solid protein in their life, because that was so important for my family. And I had nowhere to go get it. So we had to make it happen. So that's a little bit about how we got started with Shades of Gray Rabbitry and why we do an all natural product. So today I own Shades of Gray Indigenous Pet Treats, and this is my branding and my label for my pet treats. So one of the things that happened with our human consumption is Shades of Gray Rabbitry. Our pet treats is Shades of Gray Indigenous Pet Treats, and we run and manufacture this facility in Alderville First Nation. So what I do, we started in 2015 playing with the idea, we had excess meat. What are we gonna do with it at the farm, right? So I started using the feet and the ears for my dogs, because I have poodles and doodles and cockapoos, and I'm a big animal lover. That's why I farm. So my dogs are really important to me. So I started dehydrating meat for them. I started doing treats. I started doing something. My husband said, "You're nuts." I'm like, "Okay, well, whatever. It's for me. It's okay." So then I said, "You know what? We started doing shows, and I started putting packages out and doing whole bulk rolls and stuff, because we had all the equipment. My parents owned a butcher shop. I knew how to make sausage. I knew how to make jerky. I knew how to do all this stuff." So we just kind of built on that. And as we built on that, my pet treats evolved. Brian, who runs my meat room, my husband, he farms in the morning. He comes down to the meat room. He works in the meat room in the afternoon, and then he goes back and he farms at night. So we work together. It's a family unit. We have five kids from the ages of 22 to 15 now. And it's a real solid family business, and we don't waste anything. I buy all of my meat for Shades of Gray Indigenous Pet Treats from my farm. So both businesses are supporting each other, and we're doing good things, not only for animal health, but for human health. So we supply to grocery stores, restaurants, butcher shops, food lands. A lot of our meat for human consumption is in the restaurants. The chefs love rabbit meat. It is just such a versatile meat. The way you cook it, it takes on any flavor. It's just a great thing. And for our pets and for us, there's nothing healthier. That meat is so lean, it's so low in fat, and it's so high in protein that it gives us this benefit that no other meat can give us. So if your dog has allergies, hot spots, that sort of thing, this is a go-to for pets with allergies, which is a huge market right now. So during our phase of looking at our business, the one thing Brian and I focused on was our numbers. How do we get the most out of a $10 rabbit, right? How do we get the most? We use every piece of that animal and we price it accordingly. And how can we market it? And branding was the way that we market it. So this is our current branding. These are some of our packages. So we do beaver, bison, elk, rabbit, and venison for pet treats. So we stick to the four-legged, the ones that we hunt and we trap and we raise. And rabbit is our main pet treat. That is our best seller. It is our focus, because we farm it and we can control what's going into everything. We know right down to the binder what is in our feed. And this is our claim to fame with our second business, which has now outgrown our farm business. So next slide. So a couple of the things that I did with my business, and it's a little different in how we look at things. We're pretty simple people, we're farmers. So the way that we did it was we learned how to be an entrepreneur, and basically we just focused on our systems, our visibility, and our sales. So I'm not a techie. I'm really not. Brian's in the barn, that's his thing. He loves doing that in the meat room, but he's not a people person. He'll talk to you, but he's not a people person. But here, what we did was we focused on these three things, and we worked together behind the scenes to build our email marketing. We did advertising. We built a marketing team. We hired a marketing team to work with us and said, this is what we want to see with our brand. And they focus on that for us. So we've hired that out now, because that's what we had to do to build that business, because we knew we couldn't do it. And knowing where you can and can't do things well is really important when you're in business, whether it's farming or building something off of your farm business. So one of the things that we did was we thought about who are our customers, where are our customers, and what did they seem to engage with more? And we really focused on the pet treats because it grew so much quicker than our human consumption. So we started focusing more and more and more in that with our visibility. And that's where we are today in our businesses. So in the sales, we looked at, okay, what kind of different channels can we bring revenue in from? Which is how we expanded into the other proteins. And we really looked at Amazon, at any other online resource we could do. But we always came back to building our own website and focusing it on us. And how can we make everybody come to our site? How can we build that so that people understand who we are, where we're from, what we do, and why we do it? And the only way is to bring it back to you. And so that's been one of our biggest focuses and our biggest revenue generating channel is our own website. And we do that through email marketing and people that sign up and buy our product. Customers that stay with us, we focus on customer service, and they stay with us for the life of their pet. So it's like their pets to them are their children to us, right? Like our children are so important to us, and the pets are the same. They become a part of their family. So we treat them as a part of the family when they join us. One of the things that we had to really focus on with sales, though, was how do we leverage our sales and our platforms to get more sales and more operations and new customers? So we started really looking at the behind the scenes in the business and how do we do this? And how can we get more people to come and engage with us? With that, I started doing more talking. I started being involved in the powwow pitch. Going and presenting my business, asking for money and saying, this is what we're doing and why we're doing it. Can you help me? Asking was probably the hardest thing I've ever done, but I did it. And I'm so glad I did it. It has opened the doors to a multitude of opportunities. And the other thing that we really focus on a daily is whether it's the farm or whether it's the pet treat business, we focus on our numbers. Our numbers, some people, like Joe said, he's not a finance person. He's not good at math. Whether you're good at math or not, when you're operating a business, a farm business or a pet treat business, you gotta know your numbers. You have to. There's so slim margins. Even in the restaurant business, a chef will tell you, they've gotta scrimp and really work at their recipes to get their numbers down to make money because the margins are so small. So you've got to find ways to build those margins up in your business to get money. Like a lot of people are like, how much money are you getting out of a $10 rabbit? How are you profiting from that? We found a way to get a $10 rabbit to $150 a rabbit. That's a big difference, but you got to find those ways and be creative and figure out how you can do that and what you need to do with that. So that was really what we focused on. And then we focused on our best sellers. So for me, our best sellers right now in our packaging and our pet treat business is our indigenous strips. So they're our rabbit. It's the meat, the bone, the organ, simply dehydrated and grinded, nothing added, very, very simple, but you can break it into the smallest of pieces and train your dog, your cat, your ferret. So even the smallest of animals can have treat, treat, treat and not gain weight because it's meat. It becomes a part of their daily intake. It becomes a part of the habits that pet parents make and dog walkers when they're looking for that high value treat, right? So what we provide is high value, healthy treats and simply using our meat. And that becomes our best seller. And that becomes how we advertise and brand our products. So our next best seller is our rabbit rolls. It's exactly the same as our strips. It's just a different texture for your pet. It's in a roll form rather than a strip. So we're not doing anything different in our processes. We're just changing a tip on a piece of equipment. Very simple, cost effective, but we've got a brand new product. So evolving your product so it works for you to be able to still gain and build margins and have the same product producing you in different ways or different products. So that's how we've built our business, is we've just leveraged what we already had and tweaked our methods. So next slide. So what I look at when I look at my business and how I look at my business is the difference between what your business is and what you want your business to be is what you do. And what I just explained to you about the strips and the rolls, that's what you do to make your business. So a couple of things that I do with my daily routine is I set up time blocks to work on certain things, and I try and manage things that need to be done. So I know on Monday mornings every 2 weeks, I have to do the farm orders for our restaurants and our grocery stores. So I set that time block aside, I send out our emails, I get our orders in, and then I fire it off to Brian so he can get the barn ready for Thursday's slaughter. That's a given. I have to block that time off. But by doing that, I'm scheduling myself to be able to do all the work that I need to get done in the week. Between two businesses, I've got two different mindsets, right? So we set goals for ourselves and our team, and we say, okay, this is what we want to do. We track and evaluate what's working, what's not working, and we always focus on the finances and the cash flow. Cash flow is king, and it is so hard to do with two businesses. And I can tell you, this last year, I was almost panicked. How am I going to handle cash flow? Because we had so many expenses, packaging. All of our manufacturing costs are 10 times what the farm costs are. So for me to buy bags in right now, it's $30,000 at a time. Because if you don't buy in volume, you can't get the price break. So having to, even our extra meat that we buy in, we have to do the same thing, buy in volume to get the price break. So planning and tracking your cash flow and your evaluation and knowing where your expenses are is really key to knowing how you're gonna manage things during each month. So I work really hard to do that. Every day I'm working on cash flow. Every day I'm looking at budgets. Every day I'm looking at how can I tweak these things? Where can I find and cut money to make more money? Those are a really key piece for our businesses, especially farming, because feed costs went up astronomically. We went to the feed store before Christmas. We go about every 10 days. Every 10 days, our feed bill changed for the whole month. And it would just kept going up and up and up and up. And I'm like, what the heck? Finally, I said to Paul at our feed store, I said, what is going on? Why is it so much? We went from $12 a bag to $18 a bag in less than a month. That's a huge increase on a farm cost. So if I hadn't been paying attention to that and those costs, like we have to adjust our meat prices for our customers, our delivery prices because of fuel. It all costs money. And it's not just, you know, we can't pass everything along, but we have to try because it's costing us too. So when you're looking at cash flow, all those things are really, really key. So our financial plan's really key. I work really hard with our accountant and our bookkeeper to plan ahead and project where we're going to be for the next year. It kind of gives me a guideline that I can review every month and say, okay, where are my variances between my budget and my actual? And what am I going to do next month? And how do we grow? And when I say this is important, it's really hard, but it's super rewarding. This year, I started my business during COVID, my pet treat business. We started at the beginning of 2019 to build our facility. And I grew this past year 88% because I was doing these things. And it's just time management, blocking your time, taking that time to do it, to learn it. If you're going to start a farm business, I highly recommend doing this. So part of what we do, this is a little bit of our advertising. So our meat rabbit looks like the bottom picture there. When we go to the federal plant, this is what we come out with and what goes into our grocery stores. So we worked really hard. My husband created the label. That stamp is what we pay for. But believe it or not, that stamp right now is costing us almost $10. To have a rabbit slaughtered. So we have to get a lot of money to cover our meat costs. If my pet treat business wasn't there right now, our farm would be failing. So because we got creative in what we did, we were able to use what we already had in place to grow another business to support the farm. So my pet treat business right now is supporting my farm. It's paying our wages and it's supporting the feed for our animals and paying our bills. So using your systems and your lands with your growth plan is really important. But had we not had the financial background and been able to look at our stuff, we wouldn't have been able to plan for this and how we were going to move this forward. And we're constantly looking at how do we move this forward? What do we do? We run our manufacturing facility with three people. Three people, my husband, myself, and one other full-time lady. And it's great. And because we have our processes honed in and we work on these all the time, we're able to keep our staffing down, which keeps our costs down, but allows us to put more back into our business to build it. So the key for this for us was relationships that we built with other people. So how do we keep up with the demand on the meat at the farm? We can't do that alone. We can only raise so many rabbits ourselves. It's all hands-on husbandry. 90% of the work that we do, the breeding, the efficiencies of our animals, the record keeping, it's all hands-on. So how do we do that? Well, one of the things we had to put in place was how do we farm from the road? We have people farm for us. So we actually have farmers. We had a couple of Mennonite farmers that have now since gotten out of the rabbits, but we have a farmer in Quebec that farms for us. We had a Mennonite farmer down the road that farms for us, and my husband would travel, pick up rabbits, and go to slaughter because they would work under the same protocols and the same way my husband raises our rabbits. He would work with them to make sure the animals were in a good way, in the way that we would raise them with the same feed, and we were able to stand behind the product. And it was fantastic. And that's how we run and operate our business. So we farm our own rabbits, but we also have people that farm for us. And that's how we've kept up. So I've talked a little bit about splitting diversity. And the other reason we do this is because we have to split the risk. As a prey animal, a rabbit under our farm, anything could stress it out in the barn, the littlest of things. So we minimize the people that go into our barn, biosecurity for those reasons, but also for the risk of the animal. So one of the things my husband does to mitigate some of those risks is he keeps our animals at eye level with him. So they're not looking up at us and thinking we're scaring them. They're at the same level as us when we're in feeding, when we're in working with them. He handles them on a daily basis. He does their ears, he does their nails, he does their checks. They get checked for lumps and bumps and all kinds of stuff. But the one of the reasons we actually outsource some of our farming is because we have to split that risk. If one of our rabbits gets sick, we could lose the whole barn like that. It would be gone. So we had to figure out how do we mitigate that risk to build our businesses and still have confidence that we can supply and demand, right? That was one of those things. The other thing we did was we looked at how do we treat them when they get sick? How do we manage and mitigate that? So we use plants. We use plantain. We use dandelions. We go back to nature, the same as the animal would if they were sick. And we use that as our methodology for our farm business. That's how we treat and care for the animals. We go back right to their roots and how they would care for themselves in the wild. And we really take that as an important piece of our farming business. And that plays out into the quality of our product. We have chefs that tell us, don't change what you're doing. Whatever you're doing, your meat is fantastic. That's a huge compliment. And we live by that. So I guess the thing for me is be creative with your plan. Think outside the farm if you have to. How can you do this and still mitigate your risks? Because with farming, there's risks, right? Short growing seasons. If you don't have a good year, what happens to your crop? It's no different with animals. And when you're not treating with antibiotics, you can't just fix a rabbit, right? So you've got to find other ways. And sometimes it's going back to the land to do that. So we got creative with how we farm. And that allowed us to build and it allowed us to gain. And one of the key factors here is, what's the point of running a business if you're not gaining? You have to gain. We have to evolve and work so that these things continue for the future generations. So how did I leverage my businesses? I started telling you about this. NACA gave me a role model campaign after I did the powwow pitch my first year. I was absolutely fearful to do public speaking. And I challenged myself because my girls both have autism and they're really quiet. And I said, you know what? My biggest fear in high school was public speaking. I couldn't do it. Now I can do it. And it was the powwow pitch that helped me do that. it was all online and I was able to use my computer and figure out how to do it and tape it. And I did great. Well, then I built up my confidence and I was able to do more and more and leverage. So we started, obviously we're a certified Aboriginal business with CCAB. I highly recommend it. If you're starting a business and you're looking, whether it's a farm business or any other business, they have so many resources available to you, but you're also leveraging their intellectual property. So I filed for a trademark. It took me 3 years to get my trademark approved, but I want you to know I did it myself. I did not hire a lawyer. I filled out the paperwork, I sent it in, and I did it myself. You can too. It's just time. And I joined the Chamber of Commerce in Trent Hills. Now I sit as the chair. One of the other things I did was I'm a member of the Northumberland Manufacturing Association. Those are all local to me, but they've helped me build my business and gain credibility. Because I'm working with them, it legitimizes your business. And people take you more seriously because you're a legitimate member of these organizations. And you can leverage their IT to do things like apply for awards and do other things. One of the things that I did last year was I got asked to be a role model for Humber College, who was doing a business course and they're writing a curriculum on Aboriginal businesses. And they wanted to use my business model from the farm to the manufacturing facility to teach people in the business class about our businesses and how they work. And I think a large part of why I received this award for the entrepreneurship was I wrote a grant when I started farming. I wrote a grant and I got the Women's Entrepreneurship Fund. So I was very, very lucky and blessed. And as Aboriginal people, we all have these opportunities for funding. So don't look past them. Write these grants, write these opportunities as much as you can, especially as a youth. You have so many doors open to you for this. I got a $100,000 grant to build my facility with, and it was fantastic. And it helped me grow my pet treat business. I was able to leverage that ministry funding and then won the Canadian SME Entrepreneur of the Year. Like, that was pretty impressive for me. I was pretty proud of that moment, but I can use that now to advertise my business and gain credibility. So all of these things helped me move forward in my businesses. And we started at the farm and that was our main goal, just to farm meat. But it turned into this. So now I own and operate two businesses and they work simultaneously together. So one of the things I wanted to talk about a little bit was just challenges that we've had. So some of the things that we've done have taken time. Wait times are hard in business. Sometimes you're waiting on the finance guy at the back of the room there to get off his computer and call you. Sometimes you're waiting for approvals, time frames, all that fun stuff. That was a joke at Cam, by the way, if you guys don't know Cam from IAPO. I bought my farm using IAPO. So leverage the resources you have to do the things you want to do. It's there. You just got to talk to people. So the next thing was my trademark and my processes. It took me 3 years, but I got it. It sits on my desk and I've got a registered trademark for my paw print. And that paw print means everything to me because it represents our four-legged, our two-legged, our three-legged, and who I am as a person and how I present my business. The finding the right contacts in the networks, knowing you're not alone, finding groups and asking for help. There's tons of people out there that want to help you build your business, that want to help you farm. And the opportunities are endless. So we struggled with hiring staff, finding the right person to work for you. You think sometimes it's your buddy, but guess what? A lot of times it's not. It's not your family. Sometimes that's hard. Getting my kids to come and work, it's like pulling teeth some days. Other days, they're great, right? So really focusing on where you're going to have those struggles. Supply and demand struggles now with COVID. Who hasn't seen those? Everybody, right? We're short on this. We've got this. The prices went up. Those are all challenges of day-to-day stuff. But I think the thing that that has helped us is that we stayed in tune with updates and trends and knowing where we were going to do things and how we were going to buy things and looking at those perspectives and what your future holds for those things in your area. Planning where you want to go with your business and how you're going to get there. It's hard. It's a challenge to do that and to think outside the box. But if you can do it, you're going to excel. Guaranteed, you will excel and you will do what you plan to do. Putting it down on paper is so huge. So doing that is a key point. I know it seems endless and dreary and but if you do it and you have a plan, you can work from there. So technology changes have been a challenge for me. I am not a technology person. Yep. And that was really hard for me, and they're constant. So in the end, the struggle to build a business is real. We've built two of them. It's still very real and it's hard and rewarding. But the best advice I can give you is to create a community with your business and success will fall into place. And I really believe that. That's what we've done and it's worked. And I feel really good about my life. I worked really hard for Trent University for 10 years. I ran the Learning Center in Alderville for 10 years. And then I started doing this. I wish I had done this as a kid. I wish I had done this before I did anything else, because I love it. I love what I do and I love what I put out there. How did we do it? Well, we started farming with IAPO funding. I went to IAPO, I met with Cam and I said, this is what I want to do. And he helped me get there. Then I won the Women's Entrepreneurship Grant. And then the following year, did the powwow pitch. This year, you can see the difference in our meat hasn't changed. Our farm business is still the same. We haven't grown it other than I'm now buying more rabbit meat from my farm for my pet treats. But my pet treats have evolved and we are now branded. We're a well-known company. We've been in business for 4 years on the 25th of this month and we are excelling and I'm super happy with it. I couldn't be happier in terms of where we've gone with our businesses and the growth and how we farmed it. I think the big thing for me is if you have opportunities to do these things, take advantage of them. They're there for you. They will help you build your business, whether it's meat, seeds, flowers, anything. It doesn't matter what you're doing. If you have a passion for it, you can take it where you want it to go. It's all what you put into it. And like I said, I wish I had done it a lot younger. I see where I could have been now. And should have been, but it wasn't my journey. This was my journey. And this is where we are today. So thank you for having me.